Hello, and hello, Douglas. Well, I'm happy to be here to bring into being our third section of what is neo-imperialism. And that seems to have really put a burr under Douglas's saddle. And so he's been able to bring quite many amazing things to the table, especially from the miners we have over at Americans for Innovation. There's so much that's coming to surface that it's almost like we're like surfing and we're trying to stay on the board. Like we were singing, "Let's go surfing now," or I was
Hang ten, as they
singing.
say, Shaka Bra.
And so, Douglas, you brought up the whole idea of getting into the concepts that Rudolf Steiner had worked with in coming to understand the movement of history and the evolution of consciousness. And so I think it'd be ideal if you just kind of give us a few prefatory remarks so we could figure out where the conversation is going from there. As always, I have my bundle of notes, which I never seem to get around to. I have plenty of backup. So let's roll it out.
Well, you're the one who came up with the name and neo-imperialism. And really, what is imperialism? It's the First Reich, the Second Reich, the Third Reich, and what I call the Fourth Reich, the British Reich, which was an attempt to take over the German Reichs. So the First Reich, the Holy Roman Empire, of course, the Second Reich with Kaiser Wilhelm, Third Reich with Hitler, and the Fourth Reich with basically British imperialism, which seems to have topped all of them because of its magnificent efficiency. Now, what we have done in the interim is, or at least some time ago, Betsy and her team asked me to write up a an abbreviated version of three lectures Steiner gave on imperialism. Basically, because Betsy likes to squish the Queen and the monarchy of Britain, underneath her thumb. And so I just summarized it. I was very familiar with these lectures, but to summarize them in a condensed form really impacted me quite profoundly because he clearly points to the connection of the British, what he would call economic imperialism, which is a hangover from stage two of imperialism. He gives three stages of imperialism. He says the British are still stuck in stage two. But then, because they're connected to America, they went into what is called economic imperialism. So, in those lectures, condensing them, basically, I'm going to tell you what he said, and then we can go from there because it led me into some other research that really I had known about, but I had not put in such clear perspective. And so you bringing up the whole thing of let's talk about the spiritual scientific aspects of what's behind imperialism, or basically any ism, and the literally in the in this case the beings or the elemental beings that are behind it we're going to describe today. But first, to condense Steiner's three lectures on imperialism, you would say something to this effect. And you know me, I give the real short version. Short version is three stages. There was the stage when the king was directly connected to the divine, basically, as we still have an ancient tradition in Asia and all throughout Asia. The king is divine. The king is the either the sun god or the son of the sun god, and when they come down, everyone has to worship them. And they have direct connection to the spiritual world. Why wouldn't you? So your ego is totally given over to them, isn't it? And when you are captured by one king, by another, then you became the loyal subject of that king. Because why? If they conquered the other one, they must be more powerful. So of course, you give your ego as a serf, as a slave, basically, over to the ego of this king who is directly connected. Literally, not but beyond being a king, this is the divine representation on the earth. Now, in stage two, I would call that, and Steiner kind of didn't quite say this, but I'd call that the priest king stage. And you get two things that come out of that. You get the
You may
empire,
get a new metal roof installed as part of a
and
unique
you,
program.
I need a new metal roof. How did they know that?
Qualify.
So what happens is, with the priest-king stage, supposedly we believe that the priest, and remember they took over for the priestesses in 3100 BC, but anyway, the people who tended the temple, they were somehow connected through the priest rites. And then in the empire, or the imperial empire, that then was the job of the king. And so it was kind of split into two, and that's stage two, and that's where the Brits are. They still believe that their monarchy has a divine right of kings, which is absolutely absurd. Because as Steiner points out, in stage one, you have a direct connection to the divine. In stage two, all you have are the symbols and the accoutrements, the clothing, he literally says, the clothing of the king, the clothing of the queen. And by ritual, everyone gives over. And remember, with the British monarchy, they're also a church. So they're not just an empire. They are the priest king still. The queen is the head of her own Anglican church, the English church. You call it many different names, and people will argue with about this because they act like it doesn't exist. She is the head of the church. She's the head of the empire, right, at this very moment. So they are stuck in that. That was supposed to be dropped in, I think Steiner pointed out something in 1806. And basically we have, you know, the 800-year rule of the First Reich. Not the First Reich, but, well, yes, basically the First Reich. When Charlemagne was crowned by the Pope, that was a perfect example of the priest-king, and that was appropriate at that time. It's not appropriate now. So then in the third stage, because you are no longer connected to the divine, because in the second stage all you have is symbols, in the third stage all you have is platitudes. Now, people will wonder what in the world platitude means. He basically says there's either truth or there's lies. Platitudes are lies. Platitudes are what the people who rule us tell us. We would call it propaganda. And that's where I want to go in later in the conversation, is those lies create then what? Social dynamics that create laws. And Rudolf Steiner said that literally demons are created when bad laws are made, because they demand that more bad laws be made. And when your rulers lie, they create specters and they create phantoms. And we, when we're living in that lie of our rulers who are lying to us with platitudes, and except for a monarchy, as silly as the British monarchy to think they're still connected to the divine, we know that the people who are telling us these lies, like let's take, for example, Nancy Pelosi. I'm going to give you a couple quotes here of Rudolf Steiner at the when we get to that part. But basically, he says that when you tell a lie, the demons whir around you. And if you're making laws that are bad, excuse me, the scepters, the lies, the scepters whir around you. And they, he says, they whir around you. Look at Pelosi. So much is whirring around her. She almost falls over every time she speaks because it's all lies. And she's creating laws that are the worst laws ever, the attempts of laws and the that she's trying to create. If they're passed, they demand more bad laws, because the demons who are in those laws, who control masses of people, large amounts of people, through these laws, instead of having rulers who just told us this is what the divine says, as it was in the ancient times. Nope, these lies create specters, demons and phantoms. And in our own body, we have these phantoms. And if you don't digest them, and if you don't understand what they are, and if you don't know where they came from, then they actually literally become what Steiner calls bacilli or bacillum, what was at that time referred to as bacteria and viruses. And then he refers to epidemics and infectious diseases. And he says that these type of vermin come from lies, and that they oftentimes take root in rats and moles and mice and specifically bats. Coronavirus 19 is all based upon bat virus. So I hope we talk about that at the end of this. But the point is, isms, and then I'm going to jump off and get to something that you won't find in the notes. There will be the summary of those three lectures of Rudolf Steiner on imperialism that will be made available to you. But I'm going to make some references to other things that aren't. But most of these things are found very easily by going to the Rudolf Steiner archives and plugging in the word bats, and you're going to get the A Man is Creative Word, A Man is Symphony of the Creative Word, Lecture 5, where he talks about butterflies, bats, and birds. And you think, that's incidental. That's crazy. Why would, I don't know what name to use for myself, why would Thomas Douglas Gabriel bring this up? Because all coronaviruses come from where? Birds, rats, moles, mice particularly, and cancer, and certain entire streams of viruses come from mouse viruses, right? But the deadliest viruses of all come from bats. And Rudolf Steiner warned us that in the ancient times, when the priest kings ruled, they told their people, stay away from bats and don't get underneath bats, because they drop this kind of he uses different words, but he calls it droplets of, but what he's referring to is basically some type of residue that literally turns into infectious epidemics. But nowadays, that doesn't affect us anymore. What affects us are the lies of the people who rule us, their bad laws, and the societal limitations we live under, and the viruses that they have now made that are man-made viruses. It's bad enough that human lies and basically slavery, that's what our laws are, economic slavery, control us. But what's even worse is that they make man-made diseases, and then they send them out under the auspices of pandemics. And that is where true neo-imperialism went. And don't forget, the British, the best neo-imperialists of all times, are directly connected to two things that they love more than anything else. The Fabians love, and they had dinner parties where they said they wanted to kill everybody on the earth. And they love eugenics. They were the really proud eugenics. So when you get eugenics and killing people, you get the viruses, right? But then on the other hand, you have to have the propaganda under control. And that's where the isms come in. And that's what you're so good at, John, pointing out these isms are actually hierarchical beings. I'm speaking of elemental beings. But when you're speaking of isms and true neo-imperialism as it's expressed today, you're dealing with the beings that I just described, but you're also dealing with truly high hierarchical beings, very highly developed above us, who may be fallen or may be leading us. And that's the question, John, that to tackle that you gave me as the challenge with neo-imperialism was, who are we following, the fallen angels or the angels leading us in the right direction?
Well, that was a great summation. And yeah, getting into the bat lore, it brings to mind Dracul and the vampiric bats of the Eastern European lore in Hungary and Carpathia and Romania. And it's interesting because Prince Charles likes to hang out in the castle back in his relatives in Hungary. And there's this kind of strange lore that's attached to the houses of Europe. And they display it proudly. I mean, if you look at the armorial bearings of the so-called great families, you frequently see certain creatures that are to each side of the crest. And it's very often to have a dragon. And what is that dragon? Well, that dragon, especially in the image that was painted by Master Bertrand back in like before the modern era he did a lot of paintings for churches and so forth. And Rudolf Steiner comments about how he painted the serpent of Lucifer as like a human head on a snake's body. And that it was that shows you that in before the age of the conscious and soul, which began in 1413, which is what we are in now, in that earlier period, we're in the fifth period, in that earlier epoch, we were amongst a different state of consciousness. And of course, what I'm saying is very challenging to some people, and all I ask of you is, rather than garner an opinion too quickly, just hold with a suspension of disbelief, a healthy suspension of disbelief. But there's a great deal of evidence that is available if approached in the right way. You can see that earlier, before our conscious soul era, when they were back in the era of what Rudolf Steiner called the intellectual soul, there were people that retained the etheric clairvoyance, and so that you could work with them with images, and they would have a deep relationship. But that's why when you look at a lot of things that came before the modern era, and you look at it, you go, it's so simple, but to them it worked so profoundly, because they were in a certain sense deeper than us as far as having a closer relationship to spiritual impulses, but yet they didn't have the capacity that we have of detachment from the etheric world in entering into a physical type of thinking, which is, you know, I mean, it has certain advantages. Everything has its offsets, you know, so you have advantages, but you compromise something in the exchange. So that there's a certain type of technical thinking that comes to birth in the age of the consciousness soul. And but in looking at that image of that serpent, there's a lecture that Rudolf Steiner gave about the Lindworm, which is like a dragon. It's a Northern European Viking lore type dragon. And you see dragons all over the place. And there are houses in Europe that consider themselves to be of the dragon lineage. And it's included in the iconography that's worked with amongst those people. So what is that? That's their images, the imaginations that they work with. It's always when they work within the public sphere with imagery, it's an effort to try to bring everybody together under an egregore, at very least. And the creation of egregores, which is like a kind of a hive mind event, where, let's say, like in Freemasonry, for example, when you go through these rituals, you are connecting yourself with the egregore of Freemasonry, which, if you don't have the background spiritual knowledge, like the kind of things that are covered in the books that I've written or Douglas has written that are developed out of the work of Rudolf Steiner, to where you have the spiritual science to be able to understand the symbols in the right way. Nonetheless, if people go through those rituals, the symbols go into their ether body. It's just that their conscious mind is totally unaware of it. And they don't know, or can't even if they do know, it's difficult to think proper thoughts to be able to connect with them in a wholesome way. And you also see that within the Catholic Church, to where, well, if you remember, they didn't allow you in the Catholic Church to even possess a Bible. It was, you know, a crime. And so it was a big deal when these translations, you know, started to come out, Wycliffe's Bible and all of these. And so you have this democratization of spiritual knowledge, which was the backbone of culture. And like I mentioned in our last episode, that the King James Bible was really the most common book to be found in the colonies in America when we supposedly severed our ties with Britain. And most people, really, that's how they learned the language, is reading the Bible, right? And the genius behind the King James Version is so amazing. And that whole Jamesian period that ended up getting cut short, but they were working very much with this whole idea of what is the divine nature of kinship, you know, and when you get into understanding what that entails, like you have the Basilica Norum that was written by King James the Sixth of Scotland, who became James First of England, and he was the King James of the King James Bible. The Basilica Norum means, it's ancient Greek, and it means the royal gift. And he sets down what he considered to be the responsibilities of being a good king. And so you see, it's a good example of the setup with the idea of the divinely anointed king. And there was always an anointment ceremony by the Pope, right? Before the whole thing rolled out with Protestantism. But if you remember, when Charlemagne was crowned Holy Roman Emperor, it was by surprise because the Pope was there and Charlemagne was sitting there, and the Pope literally just scurried up and crowned him emperor, and thereby making it the church that was in charge of the operation. See, so he grabbed that attribute of power within that whole symbolism of being the emperor. And Charlemagne was surprised. He had no foreknowledge of the event, according to the stories. And so you see this transition from the god kings of the ancient world, like in ancient Egypt and Mesopotamia, you know, Babylon and Assyria. It was especially developed in the Assyrian culture that they worked consciously to build up that image of the king as being a god incarnate. And Julius Caesar ended up picking up. He finally had himself proclaimed a god, and they made a statue of him. You know, and you can go back to China, the Khans were considered the earthly representative of the sky god, right? And so consequently, this is a universal thing. And it's fascinating to see when you get to understand it through the concepts that Rudolf Steiner gives you with and the evolution of consciousness, it opens up a whole other level of nuance. And the whole idea of evolution, like there's Carol Quigley, who's well known for Tragedy and Hope, which is basically the biography of the Cabal, and also the Anglo-American establishment. But this is his first book, The Evolution of Civilizations. And in there, he lays out the morphology of civilizations, but it's approached from an intellectual, it's historicity in the traditional sense. He's not working with the concepts that Rudolf Steiner would work with, but there's even an inkling of the intuitive that comes to bear in some of the sources, to where Oswald Spengler's Decline of the West, for example. And so that there's that whole Faustian culture dilemma of being torn between two worlds. And right now, we have to keep in mind that this period will go into beyond 3000, so that consequently we're still in quite early stages of this development.
That's for sure. I'm sure I'm glad you brought up a few subjects I want to go back to, because I skipped them in my very long summary of Rudolf Steiner's lectures on imperialism, and that's that there are secret societies, especially in that stage, in the last stage that we're in, and these secret societies are just living with the old symbols. And in many cases, they don't even know what they mean. And he points out Freemasonry and other secret societies. And he says that they, in today's age, in his day even, they didn't understand what these symbols mean anymore. But they still have the impact, exactly as you've said. And you have brought up the symbol of the dragon. Rudolf Steiner points out that the dragon is very real. These aren't just historical analogies or some reference to something that never existed. There are dragons. And you can either tame your dragon or you can ride your dragon, and the dragon will take you anywhere that your desire wants to take you. And in today's world, the other dragon, the big dragon, has to do, Rudolf Steiner says in these lectures I referenced in the Man, A Symphony of Creative Word, Lecture 5, talking about bats, he says, the dragon loves nothing more than that human beings take in the part of gravity that bats have overcome, at which is kind of a spiritual, it's more like an excrement, but it's a secretion, and it goes into the human beings all the time. Well, this happens with birds too and butterflies. He points this out, and that's where we get viruses coming in us all the time, every breath, viruses, bacteria, all the time. But when you take in the bat stuff, it's really nasty, but because we don't notice it, it just goes right in. Well, that's the dragon when he's the happiest, is when the lies, the platitudes, the bad laws, which create more bad laws, in other words, the specters, the phantoms, and the demons, go right into us and we don't even know it. That's called a vaccine, because a man-made version of that is in vaccines, all basically most every vaccine. So when you're talking about symbols, it's been lost. But if you're trying to hang on like the British neo-imperialists are, they want to hang on to the symbol that the queen wears the crown, that the queen says that, you know, in her talks, my parliament, my government, my laws, my, the, she said my, like, I forget how many times in her last talk. It's all hers. And for some reason, the people, because they've swallowed this and it's gone into their phantom bodies, they believe that the queen is somehow more important than any other old lady on the street, which she is not. And the tradition is that of killing siblings and killing anyone in your way to get to the top of being the monarchy. And the English church was created basically because Henry VIII wanted to have a bunch of wives. So it has nothing to do with the divine. And when you swallow this stuff whole, for instance, you swallow that the Supreme Court is actually nonpartisan. If you swallow that lie and it goes into your phantom body, you have a demon living in you because it isn't true. And that's what we've been trying to point out. And neo-imperialism is based upon secret societies. And because of your good direction, you've said it again and again, and I finally come to understand it's true just recently, that the London School of Economics is pure evil. It was created by the Fabians, who sat around in England and said, how can we kill the most amount of people and disguise it through a slow process of turning everything into basically communism, bringing everything down with our isms, with these fallen angelic thoughts, or which become even higher than that. They can become archangelic. They can become the zeitgeist, the spirit of the times, an archai. And where is it percolated? In London. Where was Marxism, Leninism, Stalinism, Trotsky, all of it? Right there in London. And the Bolshevism was between London and the American International Corporation in New York, which was simply a bunch of German, Dutch, and British bankers coming to America and taking over America and starting the Bolshevik Revolution. So we have pointed all these things out, and we have never really stated that what we are dealing with is fighting with powers and dominions and principalities. And when you understand that, And you can see it over time in history and see the way that it manifests. You can begin to understand what is driving our times, because right now, illness is everywhere. We're being told it's everywhere. Why? Because the people in charge are all lying. Well, most of them. Most of the people in charge are lying. And so they're creating specters. They're creating bad laws, which create demons that control a phantom body in you that makes you get up and go to work so you can pay taxes to pay the U.S. Federal Reserve. And you think in your mind that your taxes are going for your roads and for schools and blah, blah. Not really. You know, you are hypothecated from the beginning. And this is neo-imperialism at its best. The moment that you are born, they determine how much you are going to make and how much taxes they're going to get. So British taxes have never gone away. The American Revolution never ended. We are in the attempt to create a second American Revolution that will end it, but it is only ended when neo-imperialism is ended. And that is falling apart because the distinction between the common person in Britain who no longer has free speech, has no rights, and is ruled by a bunch of laws that say the monarchy is immune from any type of prosecution and can do anything it wants. I'm so sorry for my British friends, because now it has become so clear that the European Union and Britain and the United Kingdom has gone the way of the demons. It's gone the way of laws created by the United Nations and the World Health Organization, which controls Chris Whitty in Britain and its health organizations. And in America, it controls the NIH and the CDC. So what is it we have given to demons? And I say that the United Nations is nothing but demons, because it is bad laws. It is lies. It is specters. And it creates a phantom body that is placed upon Americans through taxes that we don't want. We want our sovereignty back. We don't want pharmaceutical pandemics to basically throw away our Constitution and Bill of Rights. And that's what neo-imperialism, which is a form of globalism, through the London School of Economics, the Fabians, Cecil Rhodes Roundtable, Milner's Kindergartner, Milner's Roundtable, the Royal Institute for International Affairs, and the Council on Foreign Relations, which is what you always have quoted to me for decades, that this is the stream. And when we fully understand this stream and we see the bankers who are behind it and the families, the corporatocracy, which has become corporate lineages, when we see these banking families, we can follow the path of these specters, these demons, and we can get them out of our phantom body. Is supposed to be good, by the way. It's supposed to have all these great things. It's supposed to have what the butterflies and the birds bring us, right? Not what the bats bring us. So I'm sorry I connected up this reference to Steiner's butterflies, birds, and bats, but it's one of the simplest ways to understand it. Butterflies bring us dreams, birds bring us thoughts, and bats bring us illness. And that's the reason that the bat lady in Wuhan, Dr. Chi, is so proud that she has compounded the worst viruses ever known in history, which are taken from bats, and put them into a synthetic virus and created coronavirus 19. I mean, she doesn't say that, but she created one exactly like it, so I'm going to stretch it a bit. So this is not something of the past. This is now.
Yeah, well, when you look at it just from a in terms of just the biology that's involved, it's known amongst scientists that bats are very tolerant of viruses. And so consequently, it's very easy for a virus to exist in a bat. And you say, well, where do the actual organisms come from? When you get you can look up exosomes. And what an exosome is that your body is continually taking out the garbage, right? And same with any other animal. They're ejecting from internal parts of the cell, that there's perhaps defective DNA parts or RNA, for the most part, RNA. And so that these are ejected, and most of which are just, taken out the trash into the lymphatic system. But there are instances in the literature of which there was very few articles about exosomes until very, very recently. Actually, only in the last, 20 years or so has there even been articles on the subject, so to speak, because they're getting more advanced studies going with dark field microscopy and all that kind of technical stuff. I don't want to lose people here, get too far afield. But they make the comparison. One of the most important articles come out recently. I didn't know we were going in this direction, so I haven't brought it up on my desktop. I'd have to go look for it. But essentially, comparing these exosomes with viruses, that is essentially what it is. You can look at a virus, it's not quite alive. It's almost like a thumb drive that plugs into the receptors and gives information, can commandeer the system of a cell and propagate itself. And that's the propagation of these forms and the discrete entities known as viromes. And that all gets far too technical. I wanted to deal more with the idea of what this is, because that's the part that people aren't dealing with. Everybody's talking about virology these days. And so that's a good thing, because people are learning things that are good for the immune system, vitamin D3, vitamin C, get plenty of sun, drink plenty of water. There's a lot of things that you could do to fortify your immune system. There, circus tea is one of the greatest things. But anyways, getting back to this contagion of the life body, the etheric body, through improper use of imagery. And a platitude really is more of a worn out phrase. And so you kind of look at it, it's like these empty slogans that have been coming at us from this whole Madison Avenue advertising approach to politics and all of that. Tippecanoe and Tyler too, it's like they come up with these lines, like President Trump is working with Make America Great Again. At least he's saying something instead of Tippecanoe. I'm not sure anybody remembers what that means. And so consequently, when you get behind these things, you have to realize that you don't want to allow this egregore, this group herd mentality to get into the more dangerous areas of nationalism, that's the kind of accusatory that's coming from the left, because they're into globalism. They're not nationalists. It's kind of funny, because when you get into looking at language, it's very interesting, because they'll swap around, because you have a particular term that has to do with economics, then you have another term that has to do with politics. Well, you could have a communist monarchy. You could have one. That's very, or you could have a communist democracy, or you could have a communist dictatorship. See, so these are different terminologies, although they always get thrown together in a very confused way, and that's basically the way they like it. And due to the efforts of the miners at American Intelligence Media and Americans for Innovation, it's been laid completely to the light of day, the structure of Western intelligence, which developed out of the pharmaceutical chemical companies and the mass media conglomerates and the banks. And so this is like a fact. It's not even a new fact, but every time it seems to come up, they seem to want to make it go away. Alger Hiss, who was found guilty of being a Russian spy, he was instrumental in bringing about the creation of the UN. And he was also the instrumental person, the central figure for bringing about, in cooperation with China, the World Health Organization. So that just tells you the basis of any of these grand systems that they're trying to sell to you with this hucksterism. Oh, you're going to get all this stuff. Yeah, just like that in Venezuela, you're going to get zoo animals, which you're going to get, which is what you don't want, because then, gee, there might be viral agents that are existing in the South American tapir that you don't know about. You know, so it's kind of funny because there's another herd thing happened because there's herd immunity, and so we're continually swathed by viruses all the time, but they don't get to us. And when you become vulnerable through comorbidity or deficiencies in sunlight or vitamin D3, vitamin A, vitamin C, things that are normally good to keep you away from that, or like the Brits, they're famously like their gin and tonic. Why? Because the gin and tonic, the tonic is quinine water. And they learned a long time ago that the quinine was good to help protect them throughout the empire against malaria. And they, of course, they were the ones that they had the nickname Limeys. Why? Well, because the British doctors figured out, and they managed to keep it to themselves, why they were doing it, but they always had barrels of limes on the ship. And they go up against these other navies from like Spain and all that. And they're all unhealthy and in a bad shape. Their teeth are falling out and all this. And meanwhile, the Brits, they're eating limes, and that's keeping them happily filled with vitamin C. And so they've weaponized their understanding of medicine for a long period of time. I mean, we could do a whole show on some of the research I've done into the developing of the British Armada and how clever they were, because they were, believe me, it's because of the British Armada and the side development of the corporate system that had their own armadas, like the East India Company and all. It's a fascinating history, and Raffles there's all kinds of swashbuckling buccaneerish activity from the Brits. That's where they roll.
I think I hear you saying they're pirates. Well, you know, that's the way I hear things, you know. But I'd also like to point out that in that lecture of Steiner, those three lectures, he mentions that the Vatican is spiritual imperialism and that Britain is stuck in between, and that America or British American influences create economic imperialism. Now, these type of thoughts that the Vatican, spiritual imperialism, that they have a direct connection to the divine and that we should listen to, you know, whoever they say is the Pope because they choose a Pope. And then on the other hand, economic imperialism, where does that happen in America? Well, if you woke up, you found out that we've been vampirized, as you pointed out, much like the bats, you know, they vampirize us through the UN. And the UN is a British created organization. And at one point, Lord Malik Brown, you know, he was second in charge there, and he basically rigged every election machine in the world to make sure that the United Nations gets to state whether any election is valid or not. You know, does anybody notice any of these things? They get to state who gets sterilized. They get to state which Bill Gates vaccine is given to whom. And now they wish to vaccinate the entire world and then track that, and then with all this nonsense and no science whatsoever. So it's an ism. The United Nation ism is the dream of one world peace, one world government, one world religion, one world economy. And of course, no weapons. This is a complete imaginary construct of liars, of hollow platitudes. And it doesn't work. It never has worked. As a matter of fact, it's the exact opposite. So when we're looking at imperialism, we have to look at, I guess, the connection to the way that, as you called them, God kings, That's a really good name, because that's what they were. I mean, they were gods become humans, humans become gods, two-thirds God, one-third human. I mean, this is what they described their leaders as. Look at Zarathustra. He was able to look at the sun and see the sun god coming to earth, and the sun god gave him a golden dagger, with which he then did the hybridization of most of our vegetables and fruits that we still use to this very day. How did he know that? Well, the proof is in the pudding in the old days. But in the middle rank, when you have kings who simply want to kill their siblings to remain kings, that's not happening. And in today's world, all those lies create illness. Now, I want to point out that I'm so glad that you asked that we address what Rudolf Steiner says about some things, because then I don't sound like a complete nutcase when I read some of Steiner to you, because Steiner says things that blow your friggin' mind. So I'm going to read to you something that I think clarifies what I was saying and shows that I didn't make it up, because they sound like they're the talk of a crazy person. But this is taken from a lecture on May 30th, 1907, and I'm reading from a wonderful book. Let's see if I can get that on the screen, called Symphonies of Creation, The Primal Elementary Kingdoms and the Work of Rudolf Steiner by Oscar Curtin. One of the best books I've read in a long time. And he says here, a quote from Rudolf Steiner, "Since lie demons of this kind are always created by the great personalities of world history," I love it when he just starts in with a little phrase like that. I'm going to read that again. "Since lie demons of this kind are always created by the great personalities of world history and grow into very powerful entities, we refer to them as spirits of hindrance or hindrances. Thus, there is a form of bacillus which is the carrier of infectious diseases that originates from the lies of human beings. It is nothing other than embodied lie demons. We see here how the lies of ancient times arise in world karma as armies of entities. Just how much truth there is in myths and sagas can be seen in a particular place in Faust. A connection is made there between vermin and lies, and also in the role played by rats and mice in connection with the spirit of lies, Mephistopheles."
Yeah, one could say what they want, but the fact is that this is what you will find if you begin to research the subject in the sources themselves. Because if you study ancient cultures like I have, and you know what, like I worked as the custodian of the, not the janitor, but the librarian of one of the largest private Egyptology and Mesopotamian studies collections in the world. And it's interesting because if you dip into these sources, they tell you very straight out, the basic story is this guy showed up, and I'm putting in modern parlance, make it easier for people to digest, but this guy showed up and he taught us how to make things, how to grow things. And so it's always points back to this individual that showed up, and it's attested in Egypt. There you have a group of seven of the sons of Horus that bring the wisdom culture to them. But then you have various figures that all of a sudden there's this blooming of culture because of a particular individual that came around, and like Imhotep, who is so famous in medicine, for example, in ancient Egypt. But so there, it's completely supported by what Rudolf Steiner says about how beings from earlier stages of evolution that were like retarded angels and archangels incarnated into human bodies. And so consequently, you have a really great mixture, because some of them are really, really bad, and some of them are really, really nice, and there's every shade in between. So that things are not all equal in that regard, because some cultures, you know, they base it around human sacrifice and all of that, and there's other cultures that are more benevolent. and consequently, they go into periods of decline, and they'll go into more extreme things of the dark side in effort to maintain power. And so there's this whole periodicity of impulses that are pertaining to the relationship of mankind to the supersensible and to the realm of dream and the etheric astral levels of the universe that Rudolf Steiner very clearly describes, how the further back you go in time, you eventually get to a point to where the dream world is more real than the experience of the physical world in the earliest stage. And so consequently, you might say, well, that's like really nuts, you know, because most people, they kind of think, oh, they're like us. They just didn't have this as much information as we have now. And, you know, there's like, so you have consequently that Abbott and Costello going out and building the Great Pyramid, you know. So it's like, when it's not, that's not the reality, according to the sources themselves, which totally aligns with what Rudolf Steiner says about these ancient cultures. And so, because you look at some of the stuff, you go, how in the world did they get to this? And it's just the level of development and like the massiveness of some of the projects with these huge stones that we, you know, I don't know that we could even do today some of this stuff. So consequently, it gives you pause, to say the least. But to bring it into more of a relevant to our current dilemma, shall we say, there was a thing that Rudolf Steiner had shared in a lecture series, Things in Past and Present in the Spirit of Mankind, which he gave in Dornach in April 4th of 1916. It's lecture 4 from Things in Past and Present in the Spirit of Man. And he says, and this is speaking back again like in 1916, he says, today we live in a relatively idealistic spiritual age compared with that which will come in the future. We're living at the end of the second post-Christian millennium, and will not be long until we reach the year 2000, and then mankind will have to experience something of a special nature. Things which are preparing themselves very gradually right now are so prepared that there are two polarities which we are going to meet as time goes on. Two polarities are being prepared, one pole from the east and another from the west. In the East, things will gradually develop in such a way that another kind of thinking will dominate. Whenever a child is born, one will attempt to say, what comes of this child? We have to deal with the hidden spiritual being who wants gradually to develop this child. You will want to solve the riddle of this child. And in the first place, you will unite a kind of cult dealing with the growing up of this child. This sort of thing prepares itself in the East. Naturally, it passes over towards Europe, and the consequence will be that an immense reverence will develop for that which one calls genius, a seeking for genius. And this is what will come from the East. However, this will affect only the smaller portion of mankind. The larger part of mankind will be influenced from America, from the West, and this proceeds along an entirely different line of development. Now, I'm going to continue because it's really important and skip a few paragraphs. We might say that the present time is doing very well compared to that which will come in the future when the Western development blossoms more and more. Very shortly, when one will have written the year 2000, there will come from America not a direct prohibition, but a kind of prohibition against all thinking, a sort of law, which will have the aim of suppressing all individual thinking. On the other hand, there is the beginning achieved in this direction of suppressing all individual thinking into pure materialistic thinking, where one does not need to work upon the soul on the basis of external experiments in which the human being is handled as if he were a machine. you could see that so much has been sinned against from this other side, because today people have lost the ability to think. For example, we have machines today which add and subtract. Everything is convenient. Now in the future, you will not get a law passed which says you must not think. No, what will happen is that things will be done to the effect of which will be to exclude all individual thinking. This is the other pole to which we are proceeding. This is connected with the development of the West. You have to develop a certain counterweight against this tendency in the world development, and the anthroposophical spiritual science is this counterweight. What do we have instead? We have these brotherhoods in which these people take up the first grade, we're given symbols, then they're promoted to the second grade, then into the third, where they actually learn the symbolic, without any spiritual science being taken up by them. And if you were to ask these people if they're satisfied, they've learned certain ceremonies, hand grips, certain signs, and certain symbolic activities which occur in the temple room, they will say, ah, we're very happy with that. We do not need any more thinking. Each person can interpret it for himself in the way he wants. End quote. So, however, the situation is that we ask by real knowledge, into the etheric body, and people are produced in such a way that in their ether body they have a comprehensive knowledge, not in their physical body, not in their conscious knowledge, but in their ether body. They have an immense knowledge, particularly when I have been brought to the third degree. They have an immense unconscious knowledge, a knowledge which has been transmitted to them through symbols that can be applied honestly or dishonestly in a very significant way, end quote. Sorry for such a long quote, but it's, geez, there's so much to contemplate when you see what is going on and the way in which people just kind of fall in line with whatever team they happen to be on. And there's this whole, it's almost like watching football.
It's a perfect encapsulation of what we have to go through in our time. We are the past, the present, and the future. We are the God King, Goddess King, Queen. You know, we have to include the matriarch too. We are the priest, priestess, king, who is the intermediary. We don't need any priest now. We don't need a church. We are a church of one, Rudolf Steiner calls us, and we must find our own North Star. And as Novalis tells us, history must become a fairy tale. So when we're talking about real living thoughts, the type of thoughts just described by Rudolf Steiner in that quote, then I would suggest that you take one of the most living, active imaginations from the East, Center, and the West, which is the Holy Grail. So the Arcana of the Holy Grail, your book, is the Western esoteric path into that, if someone wants to have a deep understanding of it. I would give a simple understanding of it in this way, that we stand in between. We are our own representative, we are our own embassy, we are our own emissary into the spiritual world. Now, we have a lot of help. So as we're fighting this dragon, and remember, we don't want to kill the dragon, we want to tame the dragon and use the dragon's forces for good. And that's what people don't understand. They get down to the dragon, and the dragon rules them. But if you are a true Michaelic knight, a knight of Saint Michael, and you are fighting the dragon, and you are taming the dragon, then you are basically inviting in the cosmic thoughts of Michael, who is in direct contact with the sun being that is the god on earth that the ancients were trying to bring into their own imperialism, their first imperialism. A true spiritual imperialism of the past. Now that kingdom is in each of us. It's in our heart. And we are Michael. We are the being of Sophia, the being of wisdom. We can contact all of these hierarchies, but all of them respect our ego. And in this time, if we go to sleep with our thoughts, we fall into those things that I described earlier, the demons, the scepters, the specters, the phantom, and the whole nonsense that comes with lies that create illness in us. So you can either go unconscious and swallow what you're being told is platitudes and lies and bad laws in our time, and it'll give you illness, or You can be a Michaelic warrior and you can tame that dragon and you can become, as John pointed out before, someone who's in contact with the sky god. However you wish to describe that, your higher self, doesn't really matter. The point is, you know the difference. There's lower types of thinking, feeling, and willing, and there's higher types. And you can describe that in many spiritual ways, but basically it's very, very simple. Are your thoughts eternal? Are your feelings eternal? Are they based in love and compassion and the virtues, or are they part of the seven deadly sins going down into the realm of the dragon, the road of perdition, square to hell right now? Because heaven and hell are both in this moment as we speak. So what we're trying to bring to you is, are the tools, the sword, the shield, the helmet, all the breastplate of the warrior who fights for the divine and becomes their own God, queen, or God, king.
Yeah, I mean, in other episodes, I've pointed toward the significance of you could actually create a shielded relationship through Christ Jesus, you know, through prayer. And keep in mind that even those that are very elevated in their development have their dark nights of the soul, or where they fall from grace. All you need to do is think of in Matthew chapter 16, verses 21 to 28, and I'll share it with you. From that time forth began Jesus to show unto his disciples how that he must go unto Jerusalem and suffer many things of the elders and chief priests and scribes, and be killed and be raised again the third day. Then Peter took him and began to rebuke him, saying, Be it far from thee, Lord, this shall not be unto thee. But he turned and said unto Peter, Get thee behind me, Satan. Thou art an offense unto me, for thou savorest not the things that be of God, but those that be of men. Then Jesus said unto his disciples, If any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whosoever will save his life shall lose it, and whosoever will lose his life for my sake shall find it. For what is a man profited if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? For the Son of Man shall come in the glory of his Father with his angels, and then he shall reward every man according to his works. Verily I say unto you, there be some standing here which shall not taste of death till they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom. And so you see that Christ rebukes Peter. And it's interesting because Peter, being the first to recognize Jesus as the Christ, but yet when he falls into his lower mind and starts thinking, oh, don't worry, we're going to go get those guys. We're not going to let them get you, you know, and he ends up denying him three times before the cock crowed at dawn, right? And so consequently, he falls into his lower nature and succumbs to the wiles of the adversary. And so consequently, you have to be graceful with yourself and keep consecrating your relationship to the Christ. You know, that Jesus Christ said, I am the door. And he didn't mean he's like a door like we have back here with a doorknob. You know, he said that he's where you enter into your relationship to the light of God. Jesus said, if therefore thine eyes be single, thy body shall be filled with God's light. Now, was that a metaphor? Or did he literally mean that you're going to be filled with this light of God? So this stuff is so sacred, I'm almost uncomfortable talking about it as I have such clay feet. But nonetheless, this is where we're at. And so consequently, if you look at what the lodges are working with, he also makes interesting points regarding the multitude of degrees that are involved in Freemasonry. And basically because what we're working with in the process of initiation is that primarily the two numbers 7 and 9, and then to get off into numbers like 33 degrees in Scottish Rite Freemasonry, for example. He makes the point that Freemasons don't understand the nature of this numbering system. Like, and he mentions how Madame Blavatsky in The Secret Doctrine dealt with this riddle, because she dealt with the number 777. And he makes it very clear, it's 7 times 7 times 7. That relates to the number of globes in a chain of creation, of which we're in the fourth here in the physical earth. And so consequently, people that go through these rites and they don't have that knowledge, they're going through it unconsciously. They're going through, they think it's neat, they have all these, so they don't know what they mean, see? Like when I met with Thomas Bunyakia, the spokesman for the Hopi elders, he was very clear. Yeah, the Hopis, they call this the fourth world. Well, that's exactly what it is. The earth is the fourth in the chain after Saturn, Sun, Moon, and then Earth, and then Jupiter, Venus, Vulcan to follow. But in essence, you see that what are these earlier periods? Well, those are the stages whereby the Archai, the Archangel, and the angels, they went through their human stage back then. And now we're surrounded by these beings that have this experience of development that we don't have, because we're younger than they are, so to speak. But yet there's also the wholesome beings that so to speak, graduated during those ancient cycles. But there's also the ones that didn't graduate. They're the retarded spirits. And so consequently, it's like you're sitting in class and you're cheating off the paper of a guy who flunked the exam last year, right? And you're cheating off his paper. You know, I got this. I'm going to do really good, you know. And they get some things right. They get, you know, depends on who they are. It's as complicated as the populace of New York City. I mean, you can't just think that everything is just black and white. And so that's why when you look at the image that I put on the landing of this video, I took the image from Alex Jones, because he kind of in his own inspiration, I put there was a chessboard out there, and I guess a skull got put in the center of it. And then he had received some roses, somebody sent roses to him for whatever, just to be nice or whatever. So he put the roses behind it, and he would have people call in and comment on it. But nobody ever really got behind the symbolism of the chessboard with the tiled, black and white tiled floor, which is like a lodge, is like a checkerboard. And then you have the white and the black. And in the center, you have the skull. And what is the skull? But Jesus Christ was crucified on the hill of Golgotha. What does that mean? Well, it means the place of the skull, see? And so, and then behind it with the roses growing out of the darkness that you have, Rudolf Steiner describes the roses growing out of the black cross, and that's life coming from death. That's that continuation, that there's this continuity of life, that everything renews and continues. And so it's an interesting imagination, but yet he didn't seem to understand what it could mean. He had some ideas about it, and some people called in with stuff about voodoo and Santeria and all that kind of stuff. And there is those things. I'm not diminishing that reality. But to me, it was interesting that it was such a clear image of the point of balance between Lucifer, the white army, and Ahriman, the black army, you know, between materialism and there is no matter, it's all illusion of Lucifer, whereas Ahriman says there is no spiritual world, that's all an illusion. And the the Christ impulse is that which can find balance in between it. And so it becomes a great drama. It's like we're in this great opera in which we get to play the lead role. You know, it's actually kind of like my t-shirt or my shirt here, because it was opera. Paris opera, you know, and so the opera de Paris. And so consequently, when we get into this whole Faustian bargain, and France played a very particular role, because he also describes the French as being the most kingly of the European countries, in that they carry themselves as if they think that, you know, and so it's like God's greatest gift to mankind kind of image. And so consequently, they tend to be very insular, but that's totally eroding now. It's amazing how quickly France is slipping into a decline. It's just like, wow. I mean, it's hard to believe. But I keep going on, and there's much more we have to talk to. And so, Douglas, when looking at this whole idea of you have the phantom to the physical body, to the etheric body you have ghosts, and then to the astral body you have demon, and then with the ego you have spirits. And so that's the way that Rudolf Steiner frames it. And you see this whole idea of this falsehood politics that we're exposed to right now. They're literally giving us an onslaught of contamination on as many levels as they can at one time. But that's the whetstone by which we sharpen the blade of Michael. You know, we have to, by being able to christen your individual nature so that you're in essence like a corpuscle in the body of Christ, and that you have the wisdom, the Sophia, to be able to become an embodiment of that. That's what shields you. That at this point, there's no like a pill that you could take that's going to fully service what you need on all those levels, other than being consecrated through God in Christ, in my mind. Somebody may find it as a Buddhist, but Buddha has his specific relation to Christ. He just had the challenge of being born before Christ came along. So I questioned Gaelic Rinpoche, our mutual friend, about, you know, I said, you know, I told him, I said, you know, Buddha's with Christ now. So I told that to the Dalai Lama's cousin, you know. He looked at me. He was a jolly soul. But anyways, so Douglas, continue on. It's
well, fascinating. I think what you're saying is so true, and it just underscores the necessity of our time to be able to discern what spirit you're working with. And what you were saying about exosomes, I mean, this is what Rudolf Steiner said. He says illness comes out of the human being. So if you lie, if you believe the lies, you're going to create illness in your body. But there is a dragon out there that has us in an onslaught, and its fire is lapping about every part of our body. So we need to be able to withstand that. We need to be able to understand what the dragon is and understand our power in relationship to it. We are not helpless. Our emotions help create the weather. Our willpower and what we do in our life actually literally affects the physical earth, and our thoughts, of course, directly connect us to the spiritual world and all these hierarchies above us when our thoughts are warmed up by our heart. So when you are a true Michaelic warrior working, and remember Michael is the face of Christ, when you're empowered in that way, then you can tame the dragon. And that dragon is absolutely like the apocalyptic dragon. It's around us right now, coming from 10 different directions, and it seems as if the war of all against all has begun, but it is only a small picture of it that we see now. What we do know, though, is that victory is assured for those who can discern the spirits that you're dealing with, and that's the emphasis of what I'd like to say today. Learn to understand what these forces are, what these beings are, what these lies are, what these isms are, what history is trying to teach us. And when you take that into yourself, it's a power that allows you then to conquer your own personal desires. And that then makes you healthy and makes you able to help others along the path. And if you can do the studies that can help guide others into these lines of thought so that they can develop discernment once they see the big picture and once they understand the cosmology that has been laid out by spiritual scientists like Rudolf Steiner, then I think that that is the sword, the shield, the helmet, as I said before, the breastplate. It's all that you need for the battle for victory.
Yes. And Rudolf Steiner speaks to that very, very specifically in Basic Issues of the Social Question, Chapter 2, Finding Real Solutions to the Social Problems of the Times. And if I slip down here and find that beginning of the section, these contradictions exist because the true social meaning of these three ideals only becomes evident through an understanding of the necessary triformation of the social organism. The three members are not to be united and centralized in some abstract theoretical parliamentary body. Each of the three members is to be centralized within itself. And then through their mutual cooperation, the unity of the overall social organism can come about. In real life, the apparent contradictions act as a unifying element. An apprehension of the living social organism can be attained when one is able to observe the true formation of this organism with respect to fraternity, equality, and liberty. It will then be evident that human cooperation and economic life must be based on the fraternity which is inherent in associations. In the second member, the civil rights system, which is concerned with purely human person-to-person relations, it is necessary to strive for the realization of the idea of equality. And in the relatively independent spiritual sector of the social organism, it's necessary to strive for the realization of the idea of freedom. Seen in this light, the real worth of these three ideals become clear. They cannot be realized in a chaotic society, but only in a healthy threefold social organism. No abstract centralized social structure is able to realize the ideals of liberty, equality, and fraternity in such a disarrangement. But each of the three sectors of the social organism can draw strength from one of these impulses and cooperate in a positive manner with other sectors. Those individuals who demanded and worked for the realization of the three ideas, liberty, equality, and fraternity, which I might note is the watchwords of the revolution that are said to be sourced back to the Comte Saint-Germain, back to it, as well as those who later followed in their footsteps, were able to dimly discern in which direction modern humanity's forces of evolution are pointing. But they have not been able to overcome their belief in the uniform state, so that their ideas contain a contradictory element. Nevertheless, they remain faithful to the contradictory, for in the subconscious depths of their souls, the impulse toward the tri-formation of the social organism, in which the triplicity of their ideas can attain to a higher unity, continue to exert itself. The clearly discernible social facts of contemporary life demand that the forces of evolution, which in modern mankind strive toward this tri-formation, be turned into conscious will. So there you have it. The whole development of the American Republic is an offshoot of the French Revolution, but you see that the French Revolution took a very bad turn with Robespierre and that whole event with the guillotine decapitating all those people. And consequently, you get into that whole challenge that you referenced earlier. It's this idea of isms. And when you start getting into believing in isms, 20th century was the century of ism. You had to have an ism that you represented, whether it's communism, socialism, fascism, capitalism. There's all some kind of thing. But when you look under the hood of that, it's really what guy is behind whatever system that you're doing and how he's using and working the system to benefit his guys. And so it becomes a means of exploitation. And it goes back to the quote that's so frequently cited, and that power corrupts, absolute power corrupts absolutely. Powerful men are almost always bad men. And so it gets into this unwholesome realm. And so we have these struggling opinions and forces and beings, and it's all working together. And have a heart, because that's why you're here. You're here to experience these things. It's of value. The greater the opposition, the stronger that you will be to meet it. And but that being said, Rudolf Steiner is very clear that Jesus Christ is infinitely more powerful than the adversarial forces.
Absolutely. And the regency of the Archangel Michael started in 1879. He's the zeitgeist of our time. And he is the son of Sophia, the being of the Kyriotetes, the beings of wisdom, who work together with Christ intimately so that you actually see the being of Sophia and Christos as working together as one. So I just want to remind people that we are always surrounded by spiritual help. So when we talk about negative things, that's so that you can awaken to them, so that basically someone might say to you, that substance that you're drinking is poisonous, and then you simply stop, and you will find that it's extremely beneficial. As the Dalai Lama says, you don't even need to worry about stopping all your bad habits. Developing good habits. Just stop your bad habits. And if you can't do that, then just do one thing, and that's be kind.
Yes, absolutely. It really, when you get down to it, and amongst other friends, we've all come to the conclusion, which is the reality. It's what you do. It's you know, you're not going to go to hell for some theory that you got wrong. it may make you feel like you're in hell thinking that way, but it's not the concepts that you struggle with, but it's the actions that result from your struggle that bring you into your karma, most specifically, and on the most fundamental level. And so consequently, if you look at the Divine Comedy of Dante, it's very clear there's nine levels above, and there's nine of each of the sequences, so that it relates to that whole unfolding of awareness of the hierarchy. See, even in the German army, it was required for German officers to read Dante's Divine Comedy up until the First World War, which they've now kind of let go in terms of that spiritual focus. So you see that there's this, it's like people today that they have oftentimes have this arrogance. It's like, well, now that we're scientific, you know, we're superior to all these previous cultures, you know. It's like, it's laughable, because when you look at the depth of knowledge coming from where they were, I'm amazed in every period I've studied, and I've studied for 45 years going back from ancient cultures forward. And so consequently, the first degree in Rudolf Steiner's work, you could say the first degree is the outline of esoteric science. The second degree is knowledge of higher worlds. And then you could say that the third degree is intuitive thinking is a spiritual path, otherwise known as the philosophy of freedom. or his book Theosophy, An Introduction to Spiritual, A Supersensible Knowledge. Why is that so? Because the fundamental 3 degrees of initiation have to do with developing to be able to be a being, a body-free being, and which is an interesting concept, even though it's rarer than houndstooth to find a Freemason that knows what I just said. And that gets into that whole riddle of the murdered apprentice iconography that is at the end of the Gothic period portrayed in the great church of the Sinclairs. But that was done 70 years earlier in Normandy by one of my ancestors. And so you have that whole metaphor of that whole death through jealousy, which is that going back to the primal death through jealousy is the struggle with the sons of Adam, right? And so you have this the whole mythos of the lodges. It developed out of the golden legend of King Solomon and Hiram Abiff and all of that. And so in looking at the Christ's mission, he's there as the keystone that brings the reconciliation between Cain and Abel. You know, Cain made his offerings to God and God didn't accept them, right? You know, and that's the craftsman side, and the priest side is the Abel side. And so you have these two that are brought together and reconciled in Christ. But yet he had the vision. He said, my kingdom is not of this world. And you see in the Gospel of Luke where he says, you know, they bring him before me and, you know, we'll slay him, kind of thing. He's telling you, had they made him an earthly king, he would have been bound to act in that manner because that was what the laws would state, right? And so fortunately for the people at that time, he said, my kingdom is not of this world. He came in on Palm Sunday riding on the lowly donkey, right? He rides in on a donkey. So he's washing the feet of mankind. He's humbling himself before his creation and in an effort to have them find the capacity to rise to what he is bringing.
Well, I think the time has certainly come for people to be aware that we're not ready for a new world order or an imperialism that rules the world. From any fundamentalist point of view, to create a hegemony, we must be independent. And as you pointed out by reading about the end of those lectures on imperialism by Steiner, pointing out that the threefold social order that Steiner recommended as the antidote to this type of secret society, evil imperialism, can only be attained by a free individual. And at this moment, we are not yet that developed. And that is the reason that the threefold social order did not go forward. But individuals are that developed. And individuals can live far into the future, bringing in the future into the present. And that is what we need, is that type of inspiration, not the type of platitudes that go back to the past, that try to claim that symbols are the investiture of some type of imaginary power. No, it is your honesty, it is your love, it is your compassion, it is the higher virtues working through you that actually make you a citizen of a new kingdom, the kingdom that Christ speaks about, a kingdom in the future, that all of the things that are eternal that we do now are building as we speak. So that is our job. John and I have been doing this for a long, long time, trying to bring awareness, bring a backdrop, a framework, so that people can see where they're at, what the forces are, and where they might find their place in those forces. So I thank you for inviting me to discuss this third level of neo-imperialism, also considering the work of Rudolf Steiner, Spiritual Science, or what he called the Science of the Holy Grail. And it's always very fruitful, the work that we do in between as we think these things through. So thanks for putting the thoughts in my head to get me working on this particular project, John.
Yeah. And for those that are interested, here's my first book, The Arcana of the Grail Angel, The Spiritual Science of the Holy Blood and of the Holy Grail, a study developed out of the work of Rudolf Steiner of the underground streams of esoteric Christianity, which flowed from the Brotherhood of the Holy Grail to the Order of the Knights Templar to the True Rosicrucian Order. And this could be found on eBay. As I frequently remind people, if you go looking on Amazon, sometime it crops up for $1,000. That's not me. Anyways, and also my second book, The Arcana of Light on the Path, a more slender volume, which is a meditative tool, in essence is second degree. And my Arcana of the Grail Angel is first degree, and third degree is yet to come. And Douglas has written many wonderful books. If you go to American Intelligence Media, you can find links that will get you to them. You can get them for free. You can get them as ebooks. And Douglas, it's always wonderful having a lengthy conversation with my best friend and such a longstanding cohort. And so that being said, also, if anybody wants to donate, it's paypal.me/JohnBarnwell888. And you can check out my @JohnBarnwell888 on Twitter. And there I have the Crown Gate series all linked together. So you can gain access to a lot of the primary documents we've been able to reference, American Intelligence Media and Americans for Innovation. And I want to thank all of you for coming here and those that are supportive, and the rest of you, if you're, hey, buy me a cup of coffee. It'll be fun drinking it in your memory. Well, Douglas, so I know you got to run, so I'll let you go and have a beautiful day.
Thank you so much, John.